Good afternoon, friends. I, on behalf of Beyond Law CLC, welcome you all to all those who are participating with us on the platform as well as on the Facebook on a topic which is invariably being discussed on the legal platforms as well as on the workplace and the balance between the legal perspectives as well as the corporate perspective. We requested Ma'am Adi Lakshmi Nagamurthy and Mr. Rati Naval Rajan. We thought that there are a lot of webinars, but to have a combination of both because they are interwoven with each other, and one who is talking on law, he wants to know what are the challenges during the corporate and at the workplace actually. What is the difference between the theory and the practical aspects? As such, the combination of the two, I'm quite sacrosanct that it will go well and will have the insights in the different perspective. Ma'am, you're able to hear because somebody has posted, there's no sound.
Sound is there, Vikas. Good evening. But there is little disturbances. It's audible, but there was little disturbance in between in your voice. Good evening. You're audible.
Okay.
Hi, Rajan. I could see you.
I think the bandwidth. Yeah. And Ma'am Adi Lakshmi Nagamurthy, as we all know, has a rich experience of professionally and as well as taking different classes of different perspective. I would not say classes, because classes is in a different mindset. It's, I would say, the different way of giving or throwing light on a topic and a perspective which everybody wants to learn. And same is with Mr. Rati Naval. Both have been giving and sharing the knowledge amongst people who are willing to have the insights on such a topic. Invariably, people talk of the protection of women from sexual harassment in the short form of POSH. And people, what is the subtle difference? Because POSH, in the real sense, to some people feel POSH colony, and how to correlate between a POSH and this POSH is a different perspective. That corporate feeling of living in a POSH colony and POSH is a subtle difference, and difference in a different way, which Mr. Rajan can always explain, being from the corporate side. And without taking much time, I will request Ma'am Adi Lakshmi to take things forward. And we will also have the question and answer session. That should be around 50 minutes from here. And it can also take 1 hour. So you can post the questions thereafter. Both the speakers have been kind enough to give the consent for sharing the knowledge. And this particular program, along with the other programs, would also be, the earlier programs have been uploaded on our channel of Beyond Law CLC. This would also be uploaded, so you can share, subscribe, and like the channel of Beyond Law CLC. And over to you. Right.
Very good evening to Namaskar. Everyone there. Very pleasant evening. It is so nice. Beyond CLC is conducting a lot of webinar series. In fact, in one of the series conducted by Vikas, one of our former judge from Madras High Court, Justice Nagamurthy, I attended the session. That's why today I'm here. I got connected to Vikas. Now North and South is connected because of Vikas inviting many of our renowned lawyers from our place. Already brother advocate Srinivas Raghavan and my dear friend Ananda Gopati, Chitra Madam, and so many of them had given their insights. Today I'm going to talk on a topic, POSH. And anything when you talk about women, there might be a lot of supporters on site, and there'll be a lot of brickbats coming about even during afternoon. That's a chat. I told we will take it. Getting away from the reality, let's face the reality. That's how I have been working along. Thank you for Mr. Ratnavel Rajan, my dear brother, for joining me for today's session. So we have a short time. It's time is only 1 hour. Thank you for all the participants, my dear brother and sister advocates and other friends from HR and all walks of life to, who have joined in today on the Zoom app and also on the live, I think it's YouTube or Facebook. I think it's Facebook Live. Thank you all. Yeah, Facebook Live. Thank you. Thank you so much for all joining in. When we speak of women, definitely I do not expect anyone here to just give us support. Your ample support will not come forward. But one thing I assure you, it is not going to be gender biased. And I assure the law is also not gender biased. I request all the brothers who are listening here, just think of the mothers and sisters and your lovely daughters or your wife at your home or even your girlfriends. Then you will understand the law better than anything else. And all the women here, don't think something will be happening to us. Because when we talk about this subject, people would have faced at least one harassment in our life. Don't take it very, very serious or close to heart. Listen to it, because this will give an insight not only about the legal aspect, about what is life as such. The law predominantly is based on a judgment. In the year 1997, the Honorable Supreme Court of this country, the highest court of this country, gave a beautiful landmark judgment that protects the women. That is the Visakha guidelines, which we call about the Visakha judgment. I have shared with Vikas my notes. Along with that, I have given few judgments. You can refer that notes. Vikas will be passing on to you through the WhatsApp group. You will get. So Visakha versus State of Rajasthan, which was delivered in the year 1997, is the base of this legislation. The legislation came in the year 2013. Such a long gap. Imagine 1997 and 2013. It took so many long years for the enactment to come in. Visakha guidelines became this law as such. One particular judgment and the guidelines given in the Visakha judgment is this law, which we are going to talk about. And it is really a great, great support for all the working women of this country. And the term women or the working women or the agreed women has such a wide meaning in this. So one thing, this law is only 30 sections, and you have rules along with the law. You have to read the rules. Any act, you have to read the rules, and we have 14 rules. And it's exactly, it was enacted and it came into force 23/4/2013 was the date which this law came into force. But even today, many of the corporates, many of the organization do not have a quash committee. We know there are so many high profile cases which were referred, and only after the cases coming out, there were committees formed in even certain places. We do not want to go into the controversies. So having something like a committee, posh committee, which the law mandates, many have not taken it forward. That's why we have brought in the brainchild is Vikas to bring in a corporate perspective so that they will understand the reality, what is happening with the act. Only knowing about the law is not going to be sufficient. So who is an agreed woman? Only women. So the title itself sounds very clear. It is not gender biased, but it is in a way supporting a gender. Because when we enact this law or any particular law, when you go into the societal aspect, this is one of the social beneficial legislation. Not only this, the labor laws, the women laws, the children laws, or the transgender law, every law or social beneficial legislation. The difference between the gender law and the social beneficial legislations is, in the gender law, at that too in the criminal area, the stakeholders would be the police personnel and the prosecutors or the defense counsel or the advocates. So apart from these two people, the social beneficial legislation have so many stakeholders in it. Look at the POCSO. We have so many people, the special educators, the medical field coming in, the legal field coming in. You have the district legal services authority or the state legal services authority coming in, doing their work. So everyone will be allotted a role in all these social beneficial legislation. Again, this is one of such social beneficial legislation where the women aggrieved can be any women. When you take this particular legislation, a agreed woman need not only be a permanent employee. She can be permanent, temporary, ad hoc, getting payment or not, maybe working or a pro bono person or a trainee, or anyone can be called as a working woman in this purview, the broad purview. Even a vendor coming in an organization inside the factory for some purpose, if she faces an harassment, she can file a complaint in the committee. The committee may be her own company or her own setup or the general setup. Actually, the committee which we are talking, we have two committees in place in this law. One is the local committee, We are used to call it Internal Compliance Committee and Local Compliance Committee. In the year 2016, it was repealed, and the compliance, the word compliance has been taken away. So we have only Internal Committee and the Local Committee. Local Committee deals with where they don't have a setup, because when you have 10 or more people working, 10 or more people doesn't again specify it is going to be women. Even if you don't have any women working, so any women coming from outside or a trainee or anyone can give a compliant under this particular legislation. So a woman under this particular law need not fall into a particular category. So it has a wide perspective. This is one of the thing that protects the working women. Today, women not working is not at all imaginable. There was a time women were working only to support the family or to earn the bread and butter for certain reasons. Today, every woman who is educated or not educated, she is coming out and she is working. One thing which put off the women is the character assassination. No women will be spared when in the working place. So prior to this judgment, or exactly prior to this legislation, women couldn't find a safer place in working atmosphere. She has to leave her work, or the so-called adjust, which I never like it, or many of the women doesn't like it. They have to adjust with the situation. So this kind of thing was happening. So any woman who's working in an organization or working, even a domestic worker, I like one thing in this legislation. The first time in the history of Indian legal system, a domestic worker is protected. A woman working in your household as domestic help, she can avail the provisions of this legislation. She can go before the local committees formed in the tehsils. So a domestic worker is a new thing or a novel thing which came about in this legislation, is a domestic worker being protected for the sexual harassment. We had seen a movie called Damini, where domestic help had faced sexual harassment, rape, and she is killed. And that movie speaks of a turmoil, a poor woman she faces. But for all these things, there is one lady we all have all to salute her. There is a story behind the judgment of Visakha. The great judgment, or the landmark judgment we call, Visakha was a state of Rajasthan. The author of that great judgment is none other than the person who gave all the criminal law amendments to us. Honorable Justice Verma, who was instrumental in bringing about the criminal law amendments after the unfortunate demise of Nirbhaya, he was the person, he was the author of the judgment. He took such a great depth of study. He went into the CEDAW guidelines. He went into the constitutional provision. He took help of every other person to give us such a beautiful judgment to support the working women. And what is CEDAW guidelines, by the way? In the year 1993, India ratified the United Nations Convention on the Women's Rights. We call it CEDAW. CEDAW is nothing but Convention on Discrimination Against Women Happening. This verified in the year 1993. After this ratification, or any of the legislation of our country should be relied upon these guidelines and should follow these guidelines. So after 1993, we have a set of policies by the respective state and the central government, and we have a lot of legislation, the Protection of Women from Domestic Violence Act, the Criminal Law Amendments, and you can talk about so many legislations, and all these legislation had followed the CEDAW guidelines. And this judgment which followed or took into the guidelines given by the CEDAW, and that is also followed in the present enactment. So when you read this particular enactment, not only the 30 provisions given in the act or the 14 rules that is being given, we have to look into the CEDAW guidelines. And in the Visakha judgment, Banvi Devi, a lady working for the government of Rajasthan, and she, her role for the government of Rajasthan was to stop the child marriages. You all know, or we all know, that Rajasthan, where child marriages are still prevalent in spite of lot of legislation and lot of social activism going on. So after this particular incident happening to Banvi Devi, what she did, she just did a duty. She was in process of doing her work. She stopped a child marriage of an upper class community. And for that, she was gang raped by the men in that community. Usually women, even a small eve teasing or anything, they will never speak out. But this uneducated, not so powerful women, She came forward to fight all alone. No help came forward. And ultimately, the matter went to the Supreme Court as a SLP. There, the women organizations like Visakha came forward. And this matter came and such a beautiful judgment came forward. And today, we have a legislation. Today, this is protecting the women. And again, when we speak of women, agreed women. So a complainant in this case will be a woman. So when we speak, it's going to be women. It is not against men. It is not against particular gender. Respondent here can be a man, women, or a trans personality. This particular act or any act supporting the cause of women or protecting the women is definitely not going to be gender biased. We have an apprehension as men, many of the brothers, they were telling, you are going to talk about women. Why should I join in? Few of my friends were telling, no, I'm also going to support you in the cause. You just come in. There are so many provisions. There are checks and balances in the provisions. So it is going to support you. Just take out from your mind, any women related legislation is going to be used or misused against the other gender, predominantly the male. The respondent here is not only male. Even a woman can be a respondent. In one of the cases before the IC committee, where I'm part of it, there was one woman accusing one more woman of seeking a lesbian relationship. Initially, we were taken aback. I told this can come under POSH. The agreed person is only women, but the respondent can be anyone. So a woman seeking a lesbian favor will fall into this category. So take away from your mind, it is going to be a gender biased provision and it is not going to support any of the men. No, there is a provision under section 14, which we will be dealing little later. So you have to understand agreed women. You have to understand who is going to be the respondent. And you have to understand what is sexual harassment and what is a workplace and how it is going about. And what is sexual harassment? Generally, the word sex have a meaning and we have a mindset. The society, the conservative society says it's only going to be physical. Something happening to a woman is physical. And we have the Indian Penal Code. We have section 354, 376, so on and so forth. So many provisions. Then why at all we should have a special law? That too for a working place. Because this law doesn't only predominantly speak about something happened to your physique. Something that can be verbal. Something that can be non-verbal too. You need not speak. You need not touch a person. Even a look at a person. Even a small signal at a person, a woman, that can be construed. Even posting a pornographic picture or a pornographic material. In one of the cases where in Bangalore, I had to attend an inquiry. Here, during the process of having a committee meeting, the people were sitting and having deliberation. And one of the officers was passing on a WhatsApp message, which pornographic material to the women whom she or he had a relationship at that point of time. They were dating, actually. But that material was passed during that process. And actually, eventually, they separate and she brings it as a complaint. But it had a little malicious tinge on it also. And they finished off in a conciliation table as per Section 10. But sending a pornographic material during the course of your employment, this will fall under this category. So it is not always physical harassment as we think will only fall into the sexual harassment category. A look at a person, a word uttered by a person, sending a pornographic material, an SMS and WhatsApps. So much and so forth. When you go inside practical aspect, the law will say one thing. When you look at the practical thing, what and all it's happening, usually the men, I never thought this will become such a big issue, madam. I thought it was just a message, just a WhatsApp, just a joke. She had been so friendly with me. And I always tell people, don't take anyone anywhere friendly. That too in a workplace. We are all coming to workplace. So we cannot take anything simply and lightly. And that too women think every day and every moment in a different perspective. That's what you see. Actually, this law will be looked in from the women's perspective. If you pass a comment on me, if you tell some joke on me, I may take it very coolly today. My mood might be good. So I may take it coolly today. Tomorrow, it doesn't mean you have the right or the liberty to do it again. So all these things fall as sexual harassment. And this is spoken in section 2 and physical contact and advances, a demand or request for sexual favors. And this thing, demand or request, almost all the factory setup, you get all these kind of down south in Tamil Nadu, we have a lot of garment factories. And many of the factories where I am the consultant there, every day there'll be someone complaining about the supervisor asking for a request or all these things, making sexually colored remark. Many of the jokes, these will fall under this category. And as I told, pornographic and any of the unwelcome, as I already told, physical, verbal or non-verbal. An employer, as we know, in any organization who is in the management control or the organization under his control, so that like factories act. And if in a workplace, sexual harassment, section 3, you have to look into. As legal practitioners, sometimes it might be harassment happening that there will be a explicit consent from a woman to agree for it or an implied consent. And that consent might be a forced consent. Even anyone who's the boss, I don't think say it's male employees here. Even female employees, look into the male employees. Sometimes they'll say, I cannot say no to your boss. It's not the gender that counts. If some boss says something, you have to obey. In your workplace, you have to agree for certain terms and conditions. If it is going to have a sexual tinge on it, you will not know in the first instance. In a particular case, a senior official calls the woman and takes her for a company meeting outside and they're supposed to stay. Initially, she didn't know her intention. She obliged and goes along with them. And the male colleagues accompanying them did have an idea and they leave the place. And what will happen here for the female person here? She came with the boss or she came with the officer thinking that they are going to go for a work. So when suddenly turns into this and she has to seek for the help at that point of time. This also will come into because the vicarious liability. So workplace, when we take into the workplace, and today we have to look into the workplace scenario. The workplace scenario, the COVID has totally changed the workplace scenario. So workplace is not the factories or the four walls where we are going to work. It's not the court campus. Today I'm doing my work from my home. It's virtual court. Vikas and myself and any other lawyer, we are working from home. Likewise, many of the people, even Rajan is working from home. Many of the people get connected from home. Will it become a workplace? Because the law came in, predominantly it spoke of only the domestic worker working the home. That for that person only, the home will be considered as workplace. Because of the changed situation of the COVID, many of the organizations like the Ball Beverages recently, they have changed their policy towards the virtual working. So the home from where the women is working, and that will construed as a workplace. The vicarious liability of the organization. So that extends. And there is a recent judgment, I have put it in the notes, which says about the extension of workplace. So workplace. So an agreed woman, she has a problem, there is a respondent, and there is a sexual harassment happening, and there is happening in the workplace. So extension of this. And she has to give a complaint. Where will she go and give a complaint? And the complaint has to be given before the POSH committee. Coming to the POSH committee. Who will head the POSH committee? The senior most women of the organization, she will be heading the POSH committee. And who will be the members of the committee? There'll be, according to law, only four. But wherever I am there, I tell odd numbers are good, five. And there are organizations, there is a hospital where I am in, we have 13 people on the board. Because the hospital is such a huge and there are so many people working, and so they had 13 people. So minimum is four according to the law. And these four people, there'll be a chairwoman from the organization. She'll be the senior boss by designation. And there'll be two more people inside the organization, one woman and one man. Then they will be an external member. Who will be an external member? The rule says that. Anyone who is a social worker, concerned, a non-governmental organization working for the cause of women, she should have studied Master of Social Work and she should have worked in the field of sexual harassment. There is an NGO being run for an educational purpose. They don't do anything with sexual harassment or anything related to women. Can that person come inside? No. A person working in this perspective who knows about the practical experiences, there are so many organizations. So, an external member can be from an NGO working for the cause of women, and that too in the field of sexual harassment. And who else can be part of it? Actually, a person who is well-versed with law, the labor laws or the civil laws or the women-related laws. So any lawyer. And here I tell you, many of the organizations are recruiting only the women as the external member, but it is not gender specific. Anyone, even a man, can be part as an external member. For certain reasons or the practicality, many of the women lawyers find place. I am there in more than 20 organizations and even a part of the High Court campus, there is a sexual harassment committee there. I'm part of that. I'm working for the government here for the small scale industry. So many places I'm part of it since I've been working in this for a very long time. So the external member is essential person. Few organizations do not appoint an external member. That will be a flaw. Few persons, I have seen an organization where a man was heading the committee and HR was looking into these issues. And these things, when it comes to the court, that whole case will be done away with because the committee is not proper. For not forming a proper committee, I have cited so many judgments and given you, the committee is not proper, then the inquiry conducted by the committee will not be proper. There was a case where I was a lawyer there, where the committee conducts the inquiry, the accused, the so-called accused or the so-called offender, the so-called respondent is part of the committee. And they conducted that. And this vitiates the provisions. So I requested the women to go before the local committee of that place. This happened in Andhra Pradesh. So the local committee was functioning there. In Tamil Nadu recently, we have got the local committees. I think Gurgaon or Mumbai, the local committees are functioning very well to my knowledge. And many other places whom I have contacts, I have inquired, many places is all functioning well. So you have to go before the local committee if you have a grievance. So the POSH committee, the constitution of the POSH committee is very, very, very important. As senior most women, as a chairwoman, and the person who is inside should not have any issues or moral turpitude pending against them in any place. No inquiry against them. You have to look into that. They have a, because they are all not paid. Only the external member like me is paid. The internal people are going to do a pro bono work. So the law is very specific. Many of the judgments or recent judgments we have gone through, the problem with the committees there is only the issue there. Either they don't have a proper chairperson, otherwise they don't have a proper constitution of committee. They have brought in all the external, there was a club, we have so many clubs. There was a club, three women from outside were brought in to conduct the inquiry and they called it as a POSH committee. One thing, three minus four. And they don't have a men inside. Not having a men will also vitiate one be there in the organization, in the committee formed by the organization. So it is, you have to look into all these issues. These are the issues that come into. As a lawyer, you will be a consultant for many organizations. As a consultant, as a legal consultant of the organization, because many of you have joined in today are corporates, either your HR. Many of you are corporate lawyers who have joined in today. You will be asked to give an opinion. You might not even practice in this field at all. But understand, the committee should be perfect. Many of the, I almost cited 30 judgments. Many of the judgments say that the committee is not functioning well. I'll go to the judgment at the end. Because the paucity of time, I'll tell about the law. So the committee, chairwoman, the internal member inside, and the external member. Either a lawyer or a social worker working in this law. A lawyer, most of them are the women lawyers. Because being a women lawyer, I'll appreciate when any of my sister get the opportunity. It doesn't decide that way. One of my friend who's a male advocate here in a film distributors or producers association, he's the external member and doing a good work. So men can also get an opportunity and you'll get paid for your work. And it is an extension of your profession during this COVID situation. When people say we are not having enough job or enough work here, you can work on this. Because even online, there are so many harassments happening. I have already finished 8 inquiries in this COVID period in many of the committees I've been there. So online also, there are some little problems coming in. So this one you have to keep in mind. And all these things is fine. And you think about the inquiry. Go to section 9. Read section 2 for the definition, section 3 for... And section 4 for the constitution, 4 and 5, 6, 7, it's all speaking about the local committee. Today's topic doesn't touch about it. So one thing, if your committee is not proper, go to the Women's Commission, National or the State Women's Commission, or go to the local committee, or we can have, there is a she portal. There is a POSH committee. The POSH issues can be she portal. The website is found in the, you can search in the next place and you can file an online complaint as well. During the previous tenure of this government, they had brought in a she portal. So when the inquiry, how does the inquiry starts? All that, this is given in the rules. Some women, she is harassed. some sexual harassment may be verbal, physical, or anything. She has to give a complaint before the POSH committee. How will she know about the POSH committee? Because once the POSH committee is formed, the duty of the organization, according to Section 19 of this Act, the employers have a set of duties. The first and foremost thing is to have a policy. As exclusive POSH policy or a policy where this POSH provisions are inbuilt in it. A good policy that has to be displayed, and the committee's name and the contact numbers that has to be displayed, and every employee should know about it, and the outsider should also know about it. So this will be known to the woman and she will come and give a complaint within 3 months of last of the incident happening. Don't think Nirbhaya, but down south we had Uma or Vidya Vinodri. One day things doesn't happen. So it happens slowly. They will be friends for some time and they will get into a very good relationship and they break up or something like that. Some people knowingly, they try to contact the people, because the US Department of Justice survey says at least 70% of the crimes happening to women, anything, domestic violence, child rape, anything happening for women or even a child in the world, whole universe, it's by the known people. The offenders predominantly are known people. They will be the person whom we had any contact. Maybe your neighbors, your family members, your colleagues, or your a carpenter coming to your home, or a milk vendor, or anyone whom you would have seen at least once. 70 to 75% of crimes are happening that way. So in a workplace, when you're working, you develop some kind of friendship or relationship. But as women, I tell you now, you have a Lakshman Rekha. When you develop a friendship or a relationship, having a Lakshman Rekha is very much essential. Even before I used to, reading all these provisions, I used to think it's all unnecessary. But today's world, it's necessary. At least for the men who are listening to me, just have a relationship at your workplace where you're coming to work. Do your professional work. When getting into close relationship, I do not deny you'll fall into love, get into beautiful relationship, lovely family. I all don't deny about all these things. But if you know something might happen, don't go that extra step which creates a lot of trouble. Because later on, Section 14 will speak for you. There are malicious complaints also coming in. So when she gives a complaint, the last of the thing happening. So if a woman doesn't give, what will she do? She comes on the fourth month, fifth month. The committee has an option to give an extension of 3 months. But not like this Me Too incident, bringing in an issue after 17 years that somebody pulled my hand. Somebody sought some request. No such a long time. Me Too was a different issue. So it is a time frame given. So that time frame. And when the woman comes and gives the complaint, the committee has to look into whether it has a tinge of Indian Penal Code. If it doesn't attract 354 or 376 or any other provision, then immediately, simultaneously, the committee should ask her to give a complaint to the local police or to the National Commission for Women, whichever she agrees. If she is not going forward, that has to be recorded in the minutes that you gave an option and she disagreed with it. Later on, she shouldn't come and complain. The management didn't give an option. They compelled me to give a complaint here. This happens. Time and again, they revert back in this perspective. After taking in a complaint, that has to be in return. The committee can help her writing the complaint. Only then the men will ask, how can they support her writing the complaint? It is not to support her, because a woman coming in a jittery thing, she has to give a written complaint. And as per rule, she has to give a set of copies, hard copies, and she has to give the name of the witness or everything. So to support her, the women in the committee, the men in the committee, they will cajole and ask her to write and comfort her, give her the option of going to the police or the National Commission. So after taking down all these complaints, one copy will be sent to the respondent. Respondent again say, I tell you, it is men, women, transgender, everybody can be respondent here. Only the women will be the aggrieved women there. And the respondent has 10 days time to reply and 90 days time for inquiry. How will the inquiry be conducted here? There is a judgment, not giving an opportunity to cross-examine will vitiate the provisions. I see many of the organizations, they have women inquiring the women and the men inquiring and they gave a complaint. Definitely, it has to be conducted following the principles of natural justice, your standing orders. Everyone, please pose a question a little later, I get distracted. Everyone who comes and gives a complaint before the committee should give in the time frame. And when the inquiry goes on, the inquiry is only for 90 days. The inquiry, simultaneously, there is a complaint before the police station. And the police authorities, they take their sweet time, more than 90 days to even go for the charge sheet, or they don't do it forward. What will happen? is a double jeopardy. Having a complaint before the posh committee and having a complaint before the police, doesn't it affect the time that twice he is going to be prosecuted? Generally, in the labor provision, this is one of the set of labor legislation only. And the labor legislation, you have the domestic inquiries. How the domestic inquiries are conducted? If you have a theft, for example, theft is happening, and you have one complaint being inquired by an inquiry officer and one before the local police, it is not double jeopardy. Likewise, you have to look into these issues also. So, after the 90 days, the inquiry is prolonging for some reason. Then you can minute it up and extend for the reason. And if one person is not coming forward, you can drop the proceedings, that also minute it. This is all for the internal committee members. And if you can set ex parte also, if the people is not coming forward. So you have all the rights of a civil court. The committee is like a civil court. They have all the rights of civil court to summon, call for witness, call for records. You can ask the security to bring in the records. Because in one particular complaint, a woman gave a complaint that this particular person was harassing her. In her complaint, she had marked this as 5:45 p.m. That was the time she has marked and come in. But this particular person had checked out at 2:30 itself from the campus. So this person was telling, no, what the incident, what she is mentioning, happened between me and her outside the premises, somewhere near the bus stop. So this does not attract posh. But eventually she can give a complaint before the general law, but not here in posh. So the timing was very important. So I asked the security people to bring out the punch in and punch out details so that, so as a committee, as a civil court, you have a certain powers. So this committee is also like a civil court. You have certain powers to do it and use this power to the utmost possible manner if there is an inquiry before you. Okay, fine. Well, Section 9 speaks of all the inquiry process and Section 10 speaks of conciliation. We already heard about in the Industrial Dispute Act about conciliation and the ADR mechanism is all catching up. Why do you have a conciliation mechanism here? Do you want to have a settlement here? Here, it is no monetary settlement that will happen in the conciliation. Generally, women will come and give a complaint. Okay? She will go to the seat. The next, the seat lady will tell or someone, you've given a complaint. That's all gone. Your life itself in soup. She'll go home. Mother, mother-in-law, sister-in-law, neighbor, anyone known to them will not support a woman. This happens. Because I've been predominantly working in all the social beneficial legislations for a very long time. And I see the person comes for the first day, she will not come. Men, they come as a client from day one till day end, they will say the same thing. But women, they will have their own jitteriness. It's not because of their mindset. Because they are influenced by the outside people. They need a support system. That support system is what lacking in our country. Look at what happened to Nirbhaya. What they question, why should she come in a jeans? Why should she be accompanied by a male partner? So many questions was posted to that unfortunate girl who lost her life. The society will be judgmental on the women who is a victim herself. So this kind of society, we have to give us checks and balances. Why I'm so forceful? Because I have worked, even when this law was being enacted, I'm part of it because I was a bar leader there. So I worked on all these provisions. I met the member of the parliament who came before when we worked upon this legislation. Certain provisions we dealt in depth. And this was one provision where why there should be a conciliation mechanism was dealt by when the law was in the baby stage. So conciliation is a mechanism given to the women who wants to stop it there and not to proceed further and wash the dirty linen in public. This provision was enumerated only to support or safeguard the women who wants to finish off, because every woman will not have the guts of Banvi Devi to tow till the Supreme Court and get things. No, somewhere down the lane, the woman will have a provision given to her to finish off the matter, so show that she continues a peaceful life. So this is done. And after that, 11, 12, all these provisions speak about during the inquiry, how it you have can seek for a transfer and you can seek for leave. Apart from the leave you have, you have an extension of leave. Then we will come to Section 14, very important section. Because initially, even I was against this provision. When they asked my opinion, when we had the pre-meeting before the bill came in, before the provisions were enacted, many of the women activists and women lawyers, many of us joined and all over, we had a conference or meeting where this Section 14, malicious complaint. Initially, I was also little reluctant. What is speaks of malicious complaint? When a woman gives a malicious complaint, a wrong complaint, she will be facing the same prosecution or same provisions as per the rules, what the men or the respondent or anyone who does a mistake will face. Because every woman will not have a evidentiary value of a sexual harassment happening. Because usually sexual harassment, getting an evidentiary value is very, very difficult. Only during the cross-examination, we will be able to cult out during the answering that something is wrong somewhere. Because it will be very, very difficult for, without an evidence, any complaint given by a woman will become a malicious complaint. Then ultimately we agree because there'll be the committee has a greater role in playing this. The POSH committee, either the local committee or the internal committee, this committee will be playing the predominant role. That's why the committees are given such a great orientation in dealing with these provisions. And to be very frank, Ball Beverages, where Rajan is there, I'm part of it. They took me to Bangalore, Bombay, everywhere I went along with them to give orientation for the committee exclusively. And excellent. I like or support the people who are doing it, not only for their own organization. Rajan took pains to take it forward to general public. He invited all the HRs and invited me to give an orientation for the IC members to know how to conduct the procedures. If IC is strong enough, many of the court halls will not have the cases. Today, a lot of sexual harassment cases in form of writs are being filed before the high courts and supreme courts. That will have a reduction in the litigation. As lawyers, we like litigation, but unnecessary litigation is not needed. So the IC, the internal committee and the local committee plays a greater role in it. So malicious complaint will be understood in the correct perspective only by the committee playing here. Okay. Because this will support the men or the respondent here, because every man, most of the complaints are against men. One or two complaints I have seen against women. Only one complaint in a local committee I have seen against a transgender. Otherwise, there wasn't any complaint predominantly against women or transgender, most of the complaints. And I have seen, right now I'm working for a man who has not done a mistake. He has lent a loan of 5 lakhs for a woman. For that, he was asking her some queries. She recorded all the statement and she brought in the sexual harassment tinge in it. And I told the gentleman, put just point blank, because their office rule says not to lend money for the co-workers. Even if you have done a mistake, put it black, because instead of taking sexual harassment black mark in you, rather than you've gone against the rules, that is much better, because sexual harassment is too much. You will not even find one more job anywhere. That is the status somewhere. Malicious complaint I do even as a woman or a woman lawyer working on this field. There are few complaints being filed in a malicious tinge. This law or any women law is only to protect the woman as an armor, and it is not the weapon in the hands of the women to do away with the respondent or do away with this. Again, section 15 speaks of compensation. Compensation here, it's according to the pay pocket. We all know compensation is being given. We speak of victim compensation in criminal procedure code or many, many compensation. Even the Indian Penal Code has brought in the compensation that the fine is paying as compensation for the rape victims or the acid attack victims. So compensation has a different, here the compensation is given for the women for the, it is an extension of the punishment. Compensation is something not, you are not compensating. It's a punishment. It's a fine. It's something given on, and here according to pay pocket, if it's gone, boss going to be a big pocket, because that has to be retrieved from the terminal benefits of that employee if he's living. So you cannot just fine lakhs together to a person who's an office attender or someone. And again, section 16 speaks about confidentiality. IC is not even supposed to speak with the HR. But we do it. Practically, we do it. Not supposed to. IC has to be very, very confidential. Not to tell anything about anyone. Even Right to Information Act doesn't apply here. Right? Then you have to go, 18 speaks of appeal. And appeal is as per the standing orders. Which court apply certain labor court or industrial tribunal or your high court as per your standing orders. And 19 is the duties of the employer. What will the employer have the role to do? They should have a POSH policy. They should have a committee place and the committee should be properly functioning. They should have an awareness session. They should create a safe workplace. And so as per the Factories Act, so many provisions are there to take care of the women, everything. And the cab facilities, the night shifts, there are so many companies working here in the night shift. And that is there. And after that, is there no penalty here or is there no punishment for here for the organization? Of course, there is a penalty and a provision that is given in 26th section. When you don't follow the provisions of this law, the company or the organization or the corporate will have the license being taken away and you will be fined 50,000 for the first instance and the second offense like that. So losing a license, so losing your organization as such. So you have to have a place, a posh committee in place, that to a posh committee according with the provisions of the law enumerated herein. And all the external member or the internal member, as per the law, you have a posh committee. And after that, because of the paucity of time, because Rajan should be given some space, I'm just rushing. A few of the provisions, I'm skipping it off. And okay, I'll go. What will the other role is about the annual report. Though every committee, when they have, they will have a final report. Once the committee finishes it, they give a final report of everything. Every inquiry, and the final report will be executed by the higher ups of the organization. Annual report is something what the committee does in the whole year, right from your number of cases about 90 days, or number of awareness session, or number of cases which is then halfway, or conciliation. So much of so forth you have to go into this. And there are few judgments which I would like to deliberate. Maybe now I'll leave it to Rajan. So in the end, I'll speak about the judgments. Maybe this is Vikas. Is Rajan there?
We are unmuting Mr. Rajan also.
Okay, I'll talk about the judgments a little later when he gives the time. Thank you.
We are unmuting Rajan. Rajan, just unmute yourself.
Thank you so much. Vanakkam and Namaskar. Happy to connect as Adilashmi Akka was saying, that connecting both south, north, west. I could see people from different regions here. Thanks, Vikash, for this opportunity. It was always happy to listen Adilashmi Akka. She is our external committee member in for my organization, Ball Beverage Packaging. Personally, also, we are connected in various platforms. She is advising me in many various things. So it's always happy to share the platform with her. And so it's always good to refresh our knowledge on the law. And well done, Vikash, for doing this continuously. I could see a lot of things you are doing together to make this knowledge transfer to the people. So coming to the topic, I'm directly going to the topic now. So I'm here as a corporate representative. So I was just looking at a lot of questions which are posed by many members here. Why this law is biased? Why only men, only women are protected? Why men is not protected? What will happen when woman is giving a false complaint? Why, the Sushant case, what is the relevance to this? What after the dowry death? So a lot, many things are being put here. I think when Adilashmi, again coming to the thing, she will answer some of the things. But what I'm trying to tell you is that the questions are not new to me. Whenever we want to implement this in the corporate, many members will ask these kind of questions. When we first implemented the past internal committee in our organization, many people ask this, why there is no committee for protecting the men? Why it is only for women? So these are the questions, but we make the similar justification to them. So it's a specific law, specific act to protect women. But there are then some questions people ask, then what about the protection of men? When there is a discrimination is happening against men, what will happen? So for that, there are general laws available. There are general rules available. Every organization will have a standing order, service rule, or there are many companies like we have Ball, we have a anti-discrimination policy, so which is applicable to everyone. So no one can discriminate anybody on various aspects, right? So those all things we are attacking towards that. So I'm coming to some of the practical aspects when we are implementing this. See, one is that one most important thing what we are facing the difficulty in the corporate is the confidentiality and impartiality. She was very correctly mentioning about the impartiality. See, what will happen is that the two things are very, very important, confidentiality and impartiality. So what will happen, many times the complaints may come against a person whom you are reporting. You may be an internal committee member, but you will be investigating on a case where your boss is involved. there comes the real wisdom, okay, the real courage of going to the case without having any impartiality. And many times the organizations, the chief, like a MD or a CEO, may be also in the question. I want to tell you one small example from the corporate. A person known to me, she's visually challenged, blind. And she was harassed by somebody. Unfortunately, she doesn't know who harassed because she's blind. So she was going in the lift and somebody got into the lift and did some of the acts inappropriately, other person touched her. But she could not able to recognize who did that. It was a very, very, she given the complaint to the organization, but the organization could not able to first see who has done that. You know, the witness came from the lowest person possible in that organization. That too, that person is not even an employee of that organization. She is a sweeper, like she's a housekeeping personnel. That the witness has courageously given the witness that I saw this person also getting into the lift when this has happened. Then they verified the CCTV footages and it also given the proof. Then that person was got the punishment. So see this case, and lady was got affected, but another lady who's in the very lower level has got the courage to come forward and give the witness. But in many of the cases, it will not happen. There only the difficulty will come for being, I'm also a HR person, right? So there'll be a lot of things will come. We need to really verify that, is it really happened? In some of the cases, what will happen? Two individuals, they will be together. They will be mutually having a relationship. They'll be on a mutual consensus, they'll be having a relationship. Suddenly one day they will have a breakup. That day they will come and give a complaint. The lady will come and complain that, no, this person was telling me, he has sent a WhatsApp message like this. He is harassing me like that. In those cases, it's really difficult to earth out the truth. So that time you need to really go by that time, the help of personal members like Adalish Mehta, to have a professional people who are having experience in this field will really helpful to us. They will try to support us and help us in how to deal these kind of cases. So in this corporate, though this law is a very good law, but there are a lot of still it is in the hands of the people who are really executing it. The strength of this law is the how we are going to, the organization is going to support it. So the organization should have a clear conviction towards following all the principles of this law. For example, no tolerance, there should not be no tolerance towards sexual harassment. That should be the culture of that organization. Everybody should have the culture. That's what, as Akka said, we are doing it very, very meticulously in Ball Beverage Packaging. Every 3 months once, we are having our internal committee meeting. And every 3 months once, we are having awareness to the different set of employees. That's what we are taking the external member to the different location where and our offices are there. We are giving the orientation to them giving a lot of live examples to them. So the awareness of employees is very, very important in this. The role of the managers and supervisors are very important. They need to be a role models and they need to give the clear instruction to the people. Sometimes what will happen, there will one more thing this will also happen. Harassment might have happened, but not the sexual harassment. The people will combine only because the woman is involved, they will try to convert it to a sexual harassment. But actually the harassment might have happened, not the sexual harassment. There is a difference. For example, I need to complete this task by today 5 o'clock. I need to compulsory, it's irrespective of a man or woman. So my manager may be putting a lot of pressure on me, saying that, no, if you're not completing today, you may not be part of the job. You may be out of the job, or your increment may cut, or you may have, so that is purely a work-related, if you even call it as an harassment or a pressure, stress which is given to the employees only purely based on the work, but not based on the gender. But sometime what will happen, the person who is there as a subordinate may be a female. They will try to convert that as a sexual harassment. That also we need to be very, very careful. We need to put all the parameters, whether anything such sort is involved here, any sexual involved thing is that any physical movement is in AR, any verbal thing is in AR, any other signal or sign is there. So we need to go through all the things clearly, and we need to remove all those possibilities. Then we have to prove that this may be a coming at an harassment, not the sexual harassment. You may have to complain this against it in the standing order or service rules, whatever there. You complained in that class. Like that, we will guide them. So it's a very, very, you know, very thin line will be there. And the counseling, you need to have sometimes what will happen out of the frustration, out of this, the girl may be wanting the boy or the man to be the part of their life partner, but they might have said no to them. Sometimes that will become an issue. They will come and see that and deserted me like that. So those things, we need to have a proper counseling with the girl or person involved. Clear grievance redressal procedure in our organization. Any kind of grievances, how the redressal procedure. So these all the things will help us in ensuring that this act is implemented in the right spirit. Many places, either well, it will be two extremes. One is that they will not follow anything. They will not have internal committee. They will not have even a policy for sexual harassment. Even if there is a policy, they might not have displayed. And they should be promptly displaying overall the internal committee members, overall the external member, along with the we always display with their mobile number, with their mail ID, so that any complaint they can even directly approach them. So that should be there, because you may be thinking why it is unnecessary for the organization. But these kind of things, if you are having a putting all the proper rules and regulations and follow it and exhibit and give the awareness, no. Many times your good time will be saved. Otherwise, you will be spending unnecessary time. Time will be wasted. So it is important for running an organization. And more important thing now, everything is media, right? And a small thing has happened within the organization, in the four walls. Immediately, it will be blown out of proportion. Immediately they will share in this organization, XYZ organization, a manager has harassed a woman team member. They will put a photo, Facebook, WhatsApp, Instagram, Twitter, everywhere your company name will be damaged, spoiled. You know, before the we come to the real conclusion, your name is already spoiled. So in this only, have a proper awareness for everybody, including female, including male member. And as rightly said, it is not only the employees who are working for you. Any member who is working inside your organization, like it can be even a student trainee also. Many times it will happen. Harassment will happen to the weakest people possible. For example, a student will come for 1 month or 1.5 month. That student will expect a certificate from you, a proper this thing. So people will try to do an harassment to that kind of people. So we need to give the confidence to the student the day one itself, in the induction itself. This is our sexual harassment policy. If anything is there, any early symptom, because some of the things can be attacked. And it can be avoided if you are doing it in the very first signal itself, very first time when you are encountering itself. So we need to give that information to the people who are coming to the organization, not only your own employees. Many places, this kind of impartiality, the partiality will be there. Like for your own employees, you will take a different stand. If it is a contract employee or an outsourced employee, you will take a different stand. For any outsider, it should not be like that. There should be a common standard. So these are some of the things which we are doing very, very strictly in our organization. And we are handling with a lot of sensitivity, because every thing will have. And also we should surely follow the principle of natural justice. Many places what will happen, as soon as the complaint comes, even without seeing that, people will be immediately branding somebody as a bad person. You have to go through. The same way some places, no, always will give female who is coming. We'll try to know why you want to spoil your career. This is a small thing. Why don't you take it? So we should not do all these things. Then it will become a culture. So it is an input for the culture of the respect. The respect is a culture. The mutual respect should be evolved. And for me, this is a very, very important piece of legislation for every organization to follow. But the spirit of the thing should be followed in a very, very positive manner. And the intervention of the external member is very, very important in this. The same way, the commitment to this very top management should believe that this is for the betterment of the organization, which we as an organization believe in that. this is what I want to say to all of you from the corporate perspective. Thank you so much. Over to you, Vikash.
Both of you, as we had discussed, that the participants would get the knowledge of different sides. They say corporate and the legal perspectives are both two sides of the same coin. And until unless you understand both the issues, you would not be able to put it across. And rightly said, since there were a lot of questions, etc., going on, for some time we had disabled the chat. Now we are enabling the chat so that we would rather appreciate that if questions are asked rather than giving the comments, because invariably we are all talking and discussing. The comments are always discussed on any platform, but on this platform, let's share and ask knowledge from the speakers who can give us more, as they say, deeper roots of the what is the law and how to move forward. Like, as a lawyer, we have also seen that why they ask that a social worker, etc., should be there. This question invariably comes in the mind of a common man. The only issue is that so that it becomes a neutrality. Because a common man would always think, or the complainant would think, since there is a complaint, in largely sometimes it's said, it's converted into a sexual harassment complaint, to give a flip to that. But to have a lawyer, and it's also taken into consideration that you have a unbiased opinion, and secondly, like what Adi Lakshmi ji told, that we always have these odd numbers, so that let's assume hypothetically there could be a situation where, let's assume there are four members, both could be divided into a two each, then it's very, very difficult to move forward. So the composition in such like committees are always in odd number, so that you have a decision. Like, we are living in a democratic setup. We say that wherever the majority, that opinion of the report would be tested. And yes, one question which can come across, we will be taking questions, is whether this is appealable. Let's assume there is a report and it goes, a woman has given the report and woman feels, and the report comes against her, that it is not a case of sexual harassment. Whether it is appealable, or what is the way forward for that person who is a complainant? Yes, ma'am.
Yes, I didn't hear. Listen, you. Hello.
Yeah, I said, let's assume there is a complaint. And I will also unmute Mr. Rajan. Let's assume there is a complaint and the complaint falls on the ground that there is not much evidence. Now, what remedy is there for the complainant to challenge that particular report which exonerates against the perpetrator of the crime?
Is the complaint genuine one or a malicious one?
No. Ultimately, on the first brush, when the report comes back to the effect that there is no harassment, obviously, according to the committee, it will be that it will not be said as malicious complaint, but they will never write it's a malicious complaint. Invariably, they will write that it's a complaint where there's no evidence to substantiate that she's a victim of sexual harassment.
Okay, I understood. There are situations which can be misunderstood. In a working arena, when two or three gender kind of people are working, certain situations will be looking at each one's perspective. There was a complaint in an organization where I was working. The particular woman, she mistook a situation. Because the person was showing her an extra care and affection, which she mistook it, and eventually she files a complaint before the internal committee. And there was no any proper evidence to show it. But there are few communication between those two people, one or two WhatsApp communication, asking her to take care or be. He has been doing that. That particular gentleman is a little elderly person. His usual thing is to ask people to be taking care or enough. This was misunderstood, and this was given before the committee, before where I was in, before as a complaint and the inquiry did went through, and she didn't agree for a she didn't want a conciliation. She only wanted the inquiry to be proceeded. And during the process, we all understood it was a misunderstanding. It was not having any tinge of sexual harassment. It's only a misunderstanding. In this in-between process, we cannot give her taking it as a malicious complaint or give her any warning or any asking her to give an apology, because it is a mere misunderstanding. Many times this do happen. So we asked both of them in between to go for a counseling, outside counseling. Apart from the POSH committee, they went to our counseling and they got it set aside and come. In one case, there was a woman who gave a complaint. According to her, it was a complaint. And according to the other person, it was a malicious complaint. She didn't have any evidence at all. Actually, the inquiry went forward and we allowed the inquiry, all the chief and cross-examination. During the cross-examination itself, we could understand there is a bit of harassment. And that harassment is not sexual harassment, because that person is a strict person, is a militant boss who wants work done at the proper time, is a perfectionist. But the way he was getting the work done, she assumed this committee can take forward every kind of harassment. She didn't understand. Only during the cross-examination, we could understand. She started understanding this committee will look into only sexual harassment. She couldn't understand the difference between the sexual harassment and the normal kind of harassment, these things happening at the workplace. So these kind of complaints will not fall into malicious complaint at all. These complaints cannot be done away as just like that, because she has come forward. So here, most of the time, it goes into conciliation or goes for a counseling or they set aside. For example, there is a complaint coming as a malicious complaint. In our organization, a woman wantedly was used by the opponents of the boss to give a complaint, and that was purely a malicious complaint. But since it was planned and booked up, every record was there. They had taken some photographs in the bike stand. They have taken her, the boat getting inside the vehicle. Everything was planned. If you look at it in the first instant, even I took, why this such a good person, why he went into all these things? They checked into a hotel, they go for everything planned, even a coffee bill, everything. But ultimately, during the process, he could prove that it was a malicious complaint. And this girl, we found out it was a pure malicious complaint, and she agreed. And then somebody asked her to do it for a penny, and she agreed to do it. And she, because she was having a family and everything, 3 increment cuts were done by the committee, and she was punished according to the rules. Because 14 speaks about malicious complaint in the Act, section 10, section 14, 10, rule number 10 speaks about what all punishment can be given. Can be a warning letter, can be a written apology, can be a transfer, dismissal, suspend, everything, what you give for an offender. Here, we gave her 3 increment cuts. For a simple sum, she gave malicious complaint, and ultimately, this girl left the organization, and that person, enough was done for him. In the 3 months, everybody spoke ill of him, and it almost like he told, I lost my peace of mind here. Sometimes a malicious complaint put down the respondent, because we are all judgmental. That's why section 16 has to be followed. Confidentiality, that class, if it is followed, nothing comes out of the organization. That's why where I am there as an external member, I do not agree for the inquiry to be conducted in the campus of the organization or the factory. I ask them to do it outside, somewhere in a core work space or some external space, but not inside the organization, to keep the fullness of section 16, the confidentiality provision enumerated in the enactment. Am I clear? Vikas? We are not audible.
In fact, at the same time, the office is also working. So the staff moves on. I do it the mute way so that at least the thumping of the feet, etc., or moving of the files don't create a noise.
No issues.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Though I am dedicated for these 2 hours out here.
Yeah, only. We also conduct webinars, not like you daily, at least 3 or 4 days. You are a forerunner. We appreciate you. Yourself and Srinivasa Raghavan, sir, have been doing it for a long time, and ours, we have started it a couple of months back. What is the next question?
It's just like a marathon. You never know who comes up. And ultimately, it's like I told Mr. Srinivas, it's all mutual. I will not say it's a beyond law panel. I'm saying it's just like It's your panel. And not our panel, your panel. All those participants who are watching us on the Facebook or the
It's
a common platform. We can only move forward. The people joining us only gives the impetus to do more.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
That's always it. Okay, ma'am.
The appreciation comes from my word of mouth, but it is the whole team of lawyers here appreciate you. You have become so famous down south there. Because all our team post all your posters daily. And we appreciate you have brought the south there to the north. We have to bring the north down to the south now.
No, I'm already down.
Thank you. What's the next question, Vikas?
Yes. This is by Raghav. When we see that the act is so misunderstood and ill-used without knowing the consequence to the accused, what is done to ameliorate that?
This is the awareness session. The act. Not only this act, any act for the matter, when it comes into existence, it will be immediately misused or misunderstood. Take for example, it is not all the women laws that is going to be misused, as you put it somewhere, the 498A provision or the Domestic Violence Act or something. Look at the Right to Information Act. That is one act that has been misused. That the act came in only to get you the information needed for the general public. But you don't like the neighbor who's working in a government service, you file a right to information petition to seek some information which is not at all relevant. So sometimes acts are being misused. I do not deny domestic protection of women from domestic violence act or the one which we are talking about, the POSH. Even for instance, POCSO, in one of the cases before the Madras High Court, a wife told about the husband that he is misusing the girl or having a sexual contact with the girl, the daughter, so that she gets a divorce fast. So a misuse happens everywhere. That's how every of the social beneficiaries now has checks and balances. But what we have to do is bring in a clear-cut understanding. This is an awareness session. What Vikas is doing, what we are doing, is creating an awareness. It's not only advocates are attending. All the public are invited to attend. So we have to create the awareness session for the person utilizing this law or all the public. The real perspective, what the law is and what for the law is formed. This particular enactment, the POSH Act, is enacted. Look at the nomenclature. Prevention, prohibition and redressal. This act is to prevent something happening to women, to prohibit something happening to women. Redressal is the last thing. We are not a fact-finding mechanism. The IC committee is not sitting in to find out something happening or something there to inquire alone. We have a larger role to play. As a committee, the committee chairwomen, the committee have to bring in the awareness sessions. The awareness, here in Chennai, we have a lot of factories in Manali. The factories join together and conduct this awareness session. Likewise, we have MEP zone. So there are very many organizations like the one, there are SHARP, NIPM, all these HR organizations bring in all people together in one platform. They create awareness. This is what that is going to bring the law in the right perspective. Understand the law, what the makers of the law thought. Actually, even the lawyers will misunderstand these provisions of the many men friends of mine do not like me working on this POSH Act at all. When you go and talk about this, this is all totally against men. No, it is only against the wrongdoer. Every man is not the wrongdoer. I am living this life. I am living all my life for 50 years because of the men around me, including my son. So look at Rajan, look at Vikas, look at Srinivas. It's all our brothers. Only for the wrongdoer, this is going to be something on a Damocles sword on the head. Others, it's something like a protection of women. Many of the women are protected by men. Rajan and many brothers are helping out the women like us to do carry forward this legislation. Awareness is the only thing that will bring the law in the right perspective.
This is a question posted on a WhatsApp. It says, is there any correlation of sexual harassment in Section 354A and under this act as well? We are unmuting Rajan also so that he can chip in views.
Okay. Rajan, do you have anything to say?
You can give a view.
Yeah, I can. Okay.
I'm unmuting, but you can also continue.
There are very many provisions, some kind of act which will attract the Indian Penal Code and some other cyber laws and all. Basically, the POSH Act speaks about something happening. So the 354, mostly in corporates, 76 doesn't come into the picture, 75 or 76. But one instance, I could see 377 unnatural thing, and 354 predominantly, 354 A, B, C, and D, voyeurism is used a bit in this. So when it attracts 354 A, B, C, and D provision, the Posh committee will take in the complaint, will take in the petition, and move forward with the inquiry. Simultaneously, the woman will be requested to go before the normal process of the Indian Penal Code. She has to go before the local police to give a complaint, and she can even use the services of the National Commission of Women. Sometimes they use the services of the Legal Services Authority also if she doesn't have the provision of woman who was affected was a gardener. Then she cannot do the case all alone. It was some general manager asking her for a sexual favor, which was recorded by one of the supervisors, and everything was kept on the table. So in these kind of cases, when you have the evidence, it is very well you have to ask the women. She told, I'm a gardener. My husband is not having the capacity to run the family. I'm the breadwinner. So I suggested her go before the Legal Services Authority. To the Legal Services Authority, she went before the protection. She went before the National Commission of Women, and also she could go to the police station, because when you go to the Legal Services Authority, a panel lawyer will accompany the person, because as a Posh committee, we can direct her. We cannot ourselves go and give a complaint before the police. We cannot ourselves go and give before the National Commission of Women. Okay, and also lawyers doesn't, as per rules, lawyers doesn't play a role directly inside. So lawyers will not be able to come. They can do the external work. I am here as an IC member, not as advocate. But National Commission of Women representatives can come and file the complaint, because one thing, the rules, we couldn't have the time to say. You can be represented by yourself. You, where legal help can represent you. You can ask somebody else, and a representative can be, apart from your legal help, a National Commission member can come in, and a next friend. Most of the lawyers come in as a social activist. Adi Lakshmi is a lawyer. But if I go as a social worker, they cannot deny me the access. I can represent the women, give a complaint before the Posh or the local committee. Usually it happens before the local committee. One of the person had asked me, please explain about the local committee. From section 5 to 8, it speaks about the 7, it speaks about the local committee. There is an organization where there are no people, there are less than 10 people working. For example, there is a Xerox shop. 4 women are working in the Xerox shop. There is harassment happening to that woman from an outsider who is doing this. Where will she go? She can go to the local committee. Local committee is how it is formed. In every local area, every taluk, there will be a social worker. She will be the chairwoman. And all the there will be a representative from the SCST community, from the BC community, from the local women working there and work. Women, they form 6 or 7 people, they form into a committee, and here most of the committees are working under the social welfare department, because here every district collector office, Tamil Nadu I'm speaking predominantly, where I work, district collector office, there is a social welfare board. Under the social welfare board, there is a protection officer for the domestic violence, protection of women from the domestic violence. These protection officers also play the role of a welfare officer for the senior citizens, and also part of the local committee. So local committee is where the women is not able to file a complaint because they don't have a Posh committee, or is the Posh committee is there and the Posh committee is against her, and if she has to file a complaint against part of a person who is there in the Posh committee. So this is given in the rules simultaneously. Thank you. Rajan, your views?
Yeah, Rajan, we are unmuting. Mr. Rajan, you will have to unmute yourself.
Yeah, no. I think she has covered breadth and length of it. I'm fine. I can directly go for the next question. I saw closer to me. People are talking about the ICC committee, internal committee. Yeah. If there is a branch, because this is a very practical question. There are many big organizations. They will have the branches in different places, but they will have a committee centrally. But as per the act, actually, where there is 10 or more employees, not only the 10 or more women employees, wherever there is a 10 or more employees, you should have an internal committee there. So even there is no woman member in that particular branch, they can take the people from the other branch and make them as a member of this committee and do it. So we are also doing like that only. A particular branch is not having women employee, but they have 10 or more employees. We have people represented from the other branches. They are part of the internal committee. So so that you need not go for the head office or regional office. So we don't want to make the people to be an easy process. So that's what I said. We need to clearly mention overall the internal committee members, their mail ID, their mobile number, so that they are easily approachable.
Accessible.
Yes. And this external committee member can be the common person for all the branches also. You do not have a separate external committee member for each and every place. So the same member can be there. And in some other places now, for example, our last committee meeting, we conducted over WebEx only, like a Zoom we conducted. So we are also following the new normal. But we need to conduct the meetings regularly, because this is a situation now. People are working beyond their working hours. That 8-hour norm is gone now. People are working from morning 10 to night 10, 12 also. So there is a possibility of harassment, so that we are strictly following the working from home also be part of it. So that is very, very important for the committee to amend as per the what are the practically there are difficulties there. They need to adapt to their policies.
Thank you. Very good.
Thank you.
Any other question, Vikas?
Yeah, this is by Mukesh Tanwar. Whom to approach and complain if the district officer itself is a violator?
District officer. The women will be the heading the committee. So there is no chance of women being there. But there is someone in the committee who is a man, who is not in consensus with your complaint, you cannot give a complaint, then you can take the matter directly to the local police or the National Commission for the Women. You have a she portal. Because if you have a problem in your organization, in IC, where somebody against whom you have to file a complaint, same holds good for the local committee also. In local committee, it will again be headed by a woman. Here the person who is heading all chairwomen, maybe even the chairwomen may be common for all the places. But one lacuna is certain organization is not able to abide by it. Then you can have combined committees also, where you have two people working in the administrative office and the factory. So we have combined ICs also. So the chairwomen will be a woman and the person members will be men. If you have an issue or a problem with the filing a complaint before that committee, you can very well use the general law. So the general law is you have to go to the nearby police station, the jurisdictional police station, and you can even go to the commissioner's or the SP's office directly. You can use the services of the National Commission or the State Commission of Women. You can use the service of She Portal. She Portal is available online filing of complaints. So all these things are there. You can very well use the services of the Legal Services Authority. You have taluk level, district level, state level, national level Legal Services Authority. When you give a complaint, you get it done there. Many people do not know the provisions of legal aid being given to all the people, women especially. They will direct you to the right place where you can go. So it is not necessary only IC and LC will be used for POSH. If those two places are not accessible to you or not the right place where you get justice, if you have a feeling, you can go there direct.
This is a question sent on the WhatsApp. It says, this probably Mr. Rajan would be able to handle. Can a group of companies in service sector who have employed more than 100 workers can form a common ICC combined by a group of companies?
No, no such provision is available in the Act actually. It is not like a crush or something where you have a common crush where people can use avail the services. These committees are purposefully need to be maintained for their own the organization. That's what even within the organization itself, as I told you, if you have branches, if you have 10 or people more people are working, you need to form a committee there itself. So there is no question of forming a four or five companies together forming one committee, but the external member can be the same member for different companies. That is not an issue. But the internal committee members, excluding the external member, everybody should be the employee of that particular organization. It cannot be interchanged.
One One thing I want to tell you, the law says that if you cannot find a chairperson who's there in your organization, then you have the permission to hire them or lean them from a brother or sister organization. If you do not have a chairperson, because many organizations, you do not have top people who are women. In a few of the organizations, only the contract labor were only women. In a particular hotel industry, they couldn't find any women in the category because it is all people who are trainees and all that women. They couldn't find a chairwoman. And there was a woman cook, head cook who was doing it. They didn't find her. But I went into the hotel and I found her. I made her a chairwoman. But till she became the chairwoman, there was someone else from a brother or sister organization. They will be there. So chairwomen can be from other organization, but you cannot combine the organizations as such to make one posh committee. That's very difficult. Even in your family business, that's not possible. Some family businesses have been done in a mega. They try this, but that is not possible. Each and every unit, each and every administrative office, each and everywhere you are supposed to have a committee. As Rajan told, you can have the chairwoman or the external member common, but predominantly there should be someone, they have an easy accessibility. Because if I'm sitting in Chennai and the chairwoman is, and the whole committee is in from Chennai and Bangalore, there is a problem. Now, the person cannot contact all of us. So someone from Bangalore will be there in the committee and there may be a member inside the committee. So there'll be, technically speaking, there'll be three committees or four committees according to the units or the administrative spaces you have. That's all. Wherever I'm there, even Rajan, I'm the common person there and the chairwoman is the common person. But every unit, they have internal committee members different and three committees, one in Mumbai. Mumbai, you have two, I see. And Chennai, you I think in Sri City, you have one. You have in Bangalore. So I'm the common person. Likewise, we have a common chairperson also. Because we don't want to lend from the sister or brother organization. So we had a common person and external member, it's permitted. That is not receiving the provision. But merging from two different organizations having common committee, it's like having a local committee. Why are you not able to have one? They have the provision of going to the local committee. So this, you have to have even places, there is an organization where there is no permanent women employee. I ask them to take an external chairwoman from a thing and have, because there are so many women who are working as trainees and all. There was an organization, they called me to, even day before yesterday, one big organization wanted me to be the chairwoman. I told, bring one from your organization, I'll be the external member. So these things, practical difficulties are there. There needs an amendment. I'll tell at the end, what are the amendments needed in this act as such.
One recommendation, like what you said, what are the changes? One recommendation has come that, like, we cannot dispute that fact that sometimes male are also on the wrong side where it's being used for the purposes of harassment or some other purposes, like what Mr. Rajan also said. He says, just like the lady's name has not to be disclosed being a complainant or like it's a victim, the same way the name of the perpetrator also has not to be disclosed. So that, let's assume, ultimately he's exonerated.
Right now we have this. Section 16. Section 16 is very clear. Not only about the women. Women, witness, all the respondent. Nothing will come out. Confidentially includes the respondent as well. The name of the respondent will not be revealed. Even an organization which is going to take this person newly, if they ask them also, I have specifically told the organization where they are. Don't talk about the whatever is happening in the internal committee, all the inquiries. Don't even tell them that there an inquiry happened. This person was the respondent here. So his name is also, the present provision, section 16 is very clear. Nothing goes out. Nothing about the inquiry, nothing about the IC things need not be disclosed at all. The press, even now we cannot disclose.
Yeah, but from the corporate side, I want to add something. Though we are meeting all kinds of confidentiality in this, but as I already told you, this social media and this breaking news culture, many things are even breaking out without our knowledge. An outsider will call us and tell you that there is an inquiry going on in our organization. Confidentiality. So that's one of the very sensitive things we are dealing with, actually, because people are, even without knowing the full fact of it, even there are people who try to record the, you know, the inquiry sessions with their mobile phones, with their, you know, these cameras fixing them in the pen and other things also now people are using it. So we need to be very, very careful, very, very sensitive. As you rightly said, it is not only the woman, it's also sometimes the so-called offender, the so-called people also need to be protected, because after inquiry, if they are proved no guilty, then we need to they will undergo a lot of stress in the mind. So it is the responsibility of us to maintain the confidentiality, but we are facing a lot of issues also in that.
This is the last question we will be taking. I have received from the Facebook. It says, many times the person complaining is pushed to resign to save the person involved. Many times seniors, things are covered by putting under the carpet or diverting by putting certain blame of incompliance on the complaint. How can such things be handled?
Actually, it doesn't happen much now. But in certain instances, the women who's giving a complaint, one thing the women has to understand, she cannot bring her lawyer inside, but she can definitely take the help of the legal person from outside. Definitely when you're writing a complaint, see to that it is a properly written complaint, because many internal committee people will not have a legal person inside. They'll have an external member who is from NGO. They do not know how to, because as lawyers, we know how this case will stand. Most of the times when they call and tell, this is the issue that had happened, I'll tell this is a malicious complaint. It is a genuine complaint. It has a seriousness. Because of experience, I can tell I've been working on this. Most of the time, 99% it has turned out to be correct. So what happens is we have to be very, very careful in dealing with all these issues. Writing a complaint is not a simple issue. You have to put in your thought and process. You will be jittery. You will be all with tension. Take the help of a legal person outside. When you bring in a good complaint, when you have everything evidentiary value inside it, you have to deal it very seriously. After all, these complaints is the base for a case later on. What goes as a writ petition before the Supreme Court or High Court somewhere, the base thing is start from it. What you say is a legal notice is the base for any case. Likewise, the basic petition of the complaint is base. So this has to be very strong, enumerated with the witness, name of the witnesses and the evidence which you are bringing in, and every evidence you will not have. But you have to tell the committee, there was a security person standing there. He has punched in there. There was a CCTV camera footage. I don't have the time to deal about the case laws I have dealt in. There was one other occasion. I've culled out many of the cases from the CCTV footages, from the security people, from the receptionists, from various sources, from the person sitting next to them. We can summon anyone. The IC can summon anyone. When you give a strong case, there will be no one asking you to resign at all. And when you come and give a complaint, I tell you, all my dear sisters there, when you go and fight out in a legal arena, it will be very, very tough. I have faced a lot personally. Rajan knows, just because being an activist, working in these friends, filing a lot of public interest litigation. I was the petitioner in the Pollachi incident, one of the petitioners. Six of the advocates we filed, I was one of the petitioners there. How much I faced on the Facebook, people talking ill of me, character assassinating me, everything, talking everyone. It will happen. Not for the thing I have done. I just voiced out for someone. But as a person who are affected, there will be a lot of brickbats. Stay strong. Strength, your inner strength will take you forward, nothing else. All the sisters and all the brothers who are supporting the sisters here, I just tell you, if you're going to fight out in the legal arena, initially there'll be some hiccups, there'll be some brickbats. You have to come out of it. Then only you can stand and succeed. There is no one asking you to resign. If somebody asking me, come to Adi Lakshmi. Any man who's been wrongly accused, come to me. Any women who are not being given support, come to me. I will help. Vikas is there to help, and Rajan is there to help. The Urani Foundation is there to help. I'm all of Urani also. Don't be shying away from all these things. If you question the wrong person, then only other women will be spared. It is not only for saving your honor, saving of so many people outside. Likewise, if a man is not at fault, don't go and unnecessarily trouble the man who has not done anything for unwanted, unwarranted purposes. I do not appreciate that. I never appreciate giving false complaint. And malicious complaint is out of my purview. I never entertain any malicious complaints. Is there any other question?
The last question we will be taking, that if complainant is using the complaint as a revenge, what remedy does the male colleague have?
Yeah, the same thing. Section 14 speaks of malicious complaint. Rule number 10 speaks of the what all punishments that when given to the offender. The same punishments can give to a malicious complaint. You can give a warning letter. You can ask for an apology letter. You can dismiss. You can suspend. You can increment that. You can transfer. Looking at the voluminity of the offense she has committed, the malicious complaint was it having a lot of malicious tinge. There was one case we suspended the women for 3 months. One case where I am there, practical. She was given 3 increment was cut from her salary. In few cases, 7 or 8 cases, we had given a warning letter and asked self apology also for giving. And these cases, the malicious complaint also, the apology letter we sought for was that for boss being strict, asking her to do the work. So there are very many case files, because you can forward whatever I've given in the WhatsApp, so that there are all the case files. I put one liner also to understand what the case. First of all, the salute should go to Banvi Devi. She fought for herself and got us a legislation like this. And one another lady, the very first lady who voiced out on a sexual harassment was Rupan Dial Bajaj. But she got justice only recently. That is not justice. Rupan Dial Bajaj was the one lady who fought out, voiced out first. She didn't get any proper support. But today's women get lot and lot of support because of all the legislation and all the support system and all the stakeholders. And I should thank Rajan for joining me and thank my dear brother Vikas and the Beyond Law team for giving this great opportunity for deliberating with you. And this was one of the finest day. Even I'm very happy for talking on this topic, and you have given me ample opportunity to give my mind out. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Well, the questions will keep on pouring. And insofar as the judgments are concerned and your notes, that 21 page notes we've already shared on the Beyond Law CLC.
You can give my mobile number if anyone personally wants it, not on the chat. You can give them personally so that I can help them out. No issues.
Yeah, yeah.
If anybody has any doubt, they can ask me. No issues. Thank you.
Definitely. And so as they say, all good things do come to an end, but the parting is always difficult. I'm just unmuting Mr. Rajan. It was a session which was quite engaging, and we never realized how the time just passed away. But not passed away in that sense, but it was all knowledge flowing right, left and center. I was just finding that as if we are in a boxing ring and we are actually enjoying the entire barrage of knowledge coming here from here and there from every side. And Rajan is just giving the smiles, which speaks for all, that he has also enjoyed being a speaker and being with a co-speaker and enjoying that. That gives a different dynamism to the entire process. And thank you, ma'am, and thank you, Mr. Rajan, for connecting with us and giving the insights.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
And tomorrow, thank you. I learned a lot personally today, again from Madhavishmika. Thank you so much.
Yes, that's true.
And thank you. Rajan was good.
Tomorrow, we will be having a webinar on Consumer Protection Act at 5 p.m. with Justice Dhaliwal, who is the president of the Consumer Protection Act, Punjab State Consumer Redressal Forum. So do stay connected with us at 5 p.m. And thank you to all of us, to all the participants, not only on the Facebook, but also on the platform, and those who will watch us on the YouTube. Do stay connected with us. You can like, share, and subscribe to the channel so that you get all the webinars which have been uploaded on that. You can see any of them. So stay safe, stay blessed. And thank you, ma'am. And thank you, Mr. Rajan, and to all the participants once again. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.